Yes, yes.
Before Professor Clark begins this evening with his presentation, there's a few pieces or orders to the business at hand that we must present. And Dr. Wade Nobles will come forth and present and honor our man of the hour, Dr. John Hendry Clark. Ladies and gentlemen, sisters and brothers, Dr. Wade Nobles.
I'd like to ask Denise Sadler if she would come forward. The Honorable Ella Hugh Harris has, in the city of Oakland, has designed a proclamation in honor of Professor Clark as part of our honoring Professor Clark.
Good evening. On behalf of Mayor Elihu Harris, I'd like to present Dr. John Hendry Clark this proclamation. Whereas Oakland enjoys a diverse ethnic and religious population celebrating a history of promoting cultural exchange, goodwill, and fellowship, striving to confer tolerance, respect, and opportunity upon each individual and every segment of the community. And whereas Dr. John Hendry Clark, Professor Emeritus of African History in the Department of Black and Puerto Rican Studies of Hunter College, is welcomed to the City of Oakland and McClymonds High School by the citizens, the students, and faculty. And whereas Dr. Clark's contributions to the development of African American scholars began not in the classroom, but in the streets of Harlem, Dr. Clark, using a stepladder as his podium, he then evolved as an exceptional African-American educator, historian, critic, anthologist, and poet, sharing knowledge to many great African-American leaders, such as Reverend Adam Clayton Powell, Representative Adam Clayton Powell, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., Malcolm X, and scholars such as Dr. Wade Nobles and Dr. Asa Hilliard. And whereas we honor Dr. John Hendry Clark and thank him for the inspiration and sponsorship he has offered to countless African-American scholars who otherwise may have been discouraged and given up their pursuit of higher education, and therefore I, Elihu M. Harris, as mayor of the city of Oakland, do hereby proclaim December 12, 1992, Dr. John Hendry Clark Day in the city of Oakland.
And then on behalf of ASCAC, it is my honor to also be part of the honoring of Professor Clark. And to do that, we are honoring him by providing him with an Akan walking staff. It is symbolic for Professor Clark because the staff is the support that carries you through. And Professor Clark literally has been the intellectual staff of all the young African scholars throughout the world, not just in the United States. He represents the staff that symbolizes our uprightness, our being correct as a people, our living by the cardinal virtues of Ma'at. It is Professor Clark that has taught us to live by truth, by justice, by righteousness, by harmony and propriety and order. It is the staff that represents our strength, our foundation, and Professor Clark symbolizes the best that there is in Black intellectual thinking and action. It is with your acknowledgement and your permission that I present this staff to Professor Clark. Please note that he has on his side our future, a young Black man and a young Black woman. Their responsibility is to serve him, and in serving him, they serve us all. In honor of Professor Clark. Sade will formally introduce our teacher, our leader, Professor Clark.
All right. I must first give thanks. I have to give thanks to the Most High and to our ancestors for this special moment. And this is indeed a very, very important moment in my life, as it is in all of yours, because you're about to experience deep wisdom, ancestral wisdom, that African-rooted wisdom that is just gonna be presented through Dr. Clark by the grace of the Most High. I am blessed, I am honored, I am pleased to present my man, the man. He is the professor, has been for over 50 years, the author of over 26 books, the historian of all historians, the griot of griots. He is the healer of healers. He is the Baba. He is the genius in genius. He is the man who has been installed twice by both the Ga and the Ashanti nations of Africa. Once again, I want you, sisters and brothers, to rise with me and the Most High as we bring forth the spirit and wisdom of our ancestors through the man, Dr. John Henry Clark.
Thank you very much. My life has been mainly about the occupation of teaching and locating African people on the map of human geography and trying to understand how African people relate to the other people of the world. In my general courses on history, when I focus on Africa and ask for a new creative approach to the subject, I ask my students to place Africa at the center of world history and build all other history around that center, because that is the way it is. Sometimes when people fail to adjust to the nature of change in the world, to rising storms away from them, they pay for it because They do not understand how what is happening outside of their country reflects within their country. My mental notes for tonight's talk is African people on the eve of the 21st century. If we're going to face the 21st century, we must make major decisions as to what kind of people we are going to be. Will we go into the 21st century a subservient people, or will we go in a sovereign people? If we go in as a sovereign people, there is a price to pay. And if you go in as a dependent people, there is another price to pay. There's danger both ways. Now, if you want to be second best in this country, you can make a deal. America will make you the best, second best people on all the earth. They will equip you to fight their wars, to knock over other people's nations, to mock the cultures of other people, and destroy the gods of other people, and create the rationale for taking over other people's country so they can rape the resources of those countries. They will dress you well and they will feed you well, but you must understand, if you make that agreement with hell, you're going to have to stay in hell. What I'm trying to get across to you is that if we are going to make a new agreement with the world, we had better make a new agreement with ourselves. We must decide which road we are going to take. Will we be the support system for other people's way of life, or the vanguard of a new way of life for ourselves? We have to make that principled decision. And once we make that principled decision, we're going to have to assign responsibility to every person who's our kith and kin, and there'll be no excuses. Even the crack takers have to get off crack and get in the struggle. What I'm trying to look at is that we are in the midst of a new announcement of a new world order. How then can people make a new world order and ignore all the African people on the face of the earth? How can there be a new world order without our creative input? The new world order is a rehash of the old world order. Now let's look at the life of African people between two new world orders. The new world order, when Europe came out of the lethargy of the Middle Ages, learned maritime skill, mostly taken from China, the leading maritime nation of that day, turned on the very people that they had learned from. They had announced something that they continued to announce. They do not have the temperament to rule over other people or cooperate with other people in a democratic or Christian society. Their method of projecting themselves on the world, their rationalization for the slave trade told the world that Christianity was a lie, that democracy was a fraud. They have fostered this lie on the world until now. There is a revolt within their own ranks about whether the course of action emulating from Europe should be the course for the world, because the world is discovering itself. African people are discovering themselves in their great potential. They're beginning to realize between the United States, the Caribbean islands, South America, mostly Brazil, you might have 200 to 300 million African people. One-third of all the African people in the world live outside of Africa. These Africans in the Pacific, 16 African nations in the Pacific, millions of Africans in India, and once we come together and speak with a single voice, we're going to change the world, because we number a billion people on the face of the earth. But we have been so propagandized by the size and the might of our enemies, we have programmed ourselves into a minority syndrome, and we were never a minority. We number a billion people on the face of the earth. Now, briefly, let's build an economic system. Let's build a worldwide economic system where let's employ every black person on the face of the earth. Let's give them all a job. Let's give them all an assignment. Let's make a decision. We won't wear any shoes our people don't make. Now look at the black shoe factory you built already. Won't eat any food that didn't come from one of our farms. We'd eat more natural, less out of a can. Look at the food processing factories you got to have. We're putting people to work now. What I'm telling you, you don't have to be a beggar to a thief in the world. And you've been begging thieves for permission to live. What kind of people are we going to be in the 21st century? We're going to have to examine what kind of people have we been between the announcement of the first New World Order and Bush's announcement of a New World Order. Isn't it coincidental that they would announce a New World Order concurrent with the time there would be starvation in large areas of Africa, the world's richest continent, the world's continent most endowed with agriculture wealth, most endowed with mineral wealth, most endowed with hydroelectric potential. Africa could be the real Garden of Eden and replace in your mind that piece of folklore that you're calling the Garden of Eden. It could be a real one. What are you going to do for yourself in the 21st century?
Inasmuch as you have lived for 500 years under a Holocaust started in the 15th and the 16th century that is still intact. No one has a monopoly on the word Holocaust or genocide. Of course, we are a humane people. We can weep over people 6 million, but when we mention 60 million, we're just starting our account. If we have suffered the greatest loss of human beings from a continent in the history of all catastrophes, if we've lived through 500 years of slavery, oppression, colonialism, neo-colonialism, and now computerized homelessness, if we have survived through all of this, and other people are now extinct who suffered less, what has faith saved us to do? Isn't the African God giving us a message? If you live this far, maybe you're destined to live forever. Now let's look at this first New World Order and the consequences of that New World Order. Professor Van Sertima has said, our history is locked into a 500-year room. Let's look beyond the room, then let's open up that room and look at it. Because if we don't make some radical changes and commitments to ourselves, if we don't understand pan-African nationalism and commitment and nation structure, we'll go into another 500-year room more terrible than the one we're pulling out of. We have always been the place and the people that other people use to relieve themselves of their internal catastrophe. I would not be mentioning the 500-year room except Europe has never had enough to sustain itself, and it has always found a rationale after it has squandered its wealth in silly crusades and wars, and by failing to take care of its people through basic sanitation, plagues. What brought on this plague? The European was unsanitary. He had mismanaged himself. He had mismanaged his land. He had created a system of white slavery that lasted 1,000 years called feudalism. He had drained his resources going across the Europe to look for a holy grail that wasn't holy in the first place, wasn't lost in the second place. He built elaborate churches at the expense of the people. He created something called purgatory. At one of the great con games the church has ever played. Grandma dies, grandma don't go to heaven. Had to stop off in purgatory. Now you got to pray her from purgatory into heaven. And the more money you give to the priest, the harder he pray to get grandma from purgatory into heaven. It was a racket. If you understand the games your oppressor plays on his kith and kin, you might understand the game he's playing on you. And the main game he's playing on you was to colonize history, remove you from the respectful commentary of history, colonize information about history. Then the most disastrous of all, the colonizing of image, especially the image of God. Now, will you go into the 21st century worshiping a picture as Christ painted by Michelangelo? Will you go into the 21st century looking with dewy eyes at the story of the Last Supper without knowing that Michelangelo had one professional model and couldn't pay any more? So he was thinking, where can I find some new models that look cheap? So he raided the jails and got some jailbirds who weren't doing much anyway. And they became the disciples. Because you are so poor at research, you look at pictures that's supposed to be holy, and you feel so pious. Oh, that's Peter sitting over there. In the 21st century, will you let people still play these kind of games on you? Or will you look beyond their dogmatization of Christianity, dogmatizing religion you already had, formalizing that religion around a personality called Jesus Christ? Now, will you look beyond that and realize you had the same religion 3,000 years before? And you didn't call it anything. You just lived it out. You had democracy before the Greeks had shoes. I lived in a house that had a window. You didn't shout, "Look, Mama, I'm democratic." You just lived it out. And this fool would come along with the religion, said, "I am my brother's keeper." And if you have to say you're your brother's keeper, I suspect you don't want to keep it. But if you're honest, you just keep it. No announcements are necessary. The same as the black and beautiful game you play on yourself, washing your ego without moving one step forward. I am black and I am beautiful. You might as well tell me the sun is shining. I know you're black and beautiful, so what else is new? This world is not run by blackness and it's not run by beauty. It's run by power. And if you're not black and powerful, you're spinning your wheels and going nowhere. If we understand the word games we play on each other, and the fact that we fail to distinguish between education and training, your enemy can't afford to educate you, because once you know who he is, you know what you have to be. Education has but one honorable purpose, one alone. Everything else is a waste of time, and that is to train the student to be a responsible handler of power. I got a secret for you. I couldn't sell it. I'm going to give it to you free.
The meek will not inherit the earth. If the day came when the meek inherited the earth, the strong will inherit the meek and nothing will change. Because the meek can't hold the world together. People have to have strength and have to have organization. Now when the Europeans came out into the world, they were telling each other fairy tales about whether the world was wrong, round or flat. These were fairy tales. And once they understood maritime shipping again, understood that vast world beyond Europe, they said, round or flat, I want all of it. And they violated every rule of every decent religion on the face of the earth, but they took all of it. And they're not going to give it back without a fight. We've got some people living in a world of fantasy. Some people in the NACP of South Africa, the ANC, talking about power sharing. Powerful people never share power with weak people. If someone's got something that belongs to you like a nation, you don't come to power and share with him. You kick butt and take back what belongs to you. Everybody in the world, once they get an upper hand, they kick butt. Now, once you get an upper hand, you're going to share power. Well, what kind of world are you living in? It's totally unreal. Walt Disney needs to come back and give you another world with more family. For you are kidding yourself. Now, as you go into the 21st century, we've got to regain the main thing we lost in the 15th and the 16th century, the nation structure. We must live in nations not only developed by our own creative imagination, but nations that respect our culture and our belief system. And it does not matter whether it's called Christian or Protestant. You have to understand something about all of the major organized religions. All of them are male chauvinist murder cults. All of the elements that went into the making of these religions came out of Nile Valley civilizations in Africa. So don't give me any nonsense about Islam being the black man's true religion. All religions are the black man's true religion. Because all of them came out of the spirituality and the belief system he had before fools, foreigners, and fakers develop something called religion. Look at ancient African languages. I defy you to find me the definition of religion in any African ancient language. Because to the everlasting credit of African people, they gave the world no religion. They gave the world something higher than religion, spirituality.
You can be a great spiritual people, and you're never going to be free until you're a great spiritual people, until you pay attention to your culture, pay attention to your family, pay attention to your home, attention to your community. I'm suggesting something here that might not go down well with you. I'm suggesting we re-tribalize ourselves. I mean, block by block, this is A block. And if A block sees a man, you know, mauling a woman on the street, he said, no, look, we don't stand that here. And you get enough muscle around him to put a hurting on him, and he'll know that, no, you might have to go some other block, not this one. Because the A block people don't stand for that. No loud talk. Now have fun, of course, but keep your language clear. We don't want our children's mind to be polluted to it. We pay attention to all the children in this block. Every child belongs to every parent. We got collective parenting. We know who the natural parent is, but we got a collective parent. I grew up in a collective community in Alabama and Georgia. If I got wrong or did something wrong, any adult could put a whipping on me. And if they took me home, I got a better one. So when we forgot what kind of society we came out of and got into the individual bag of people who came out of an icebox society where he had to oppose his brother for his breakfast, of fighting his brother over a bag of bones. We forgot that we came out of a tropical climate where nature was kind. We could pick up a breakfast from a bush, could fish it out of a stream. Even today, we are great dinner givers. One of the main reasons we're always inviting people to dinner, that we grew up in a society where we had plenty of dinner. Then we encountered a people from a stingy society that didn't even have enough to feed his children. He accepted and interpreted our generosity as surrender. Hadn't understood it yet, and you're not too clear on it. You know the old beautiful customs we had in the South? Now you can't leave my house without at least having a piece of cake and some coffee. You offend my house if you don't eat something. What have I done to you? And my family was noted for great cooks except my stepmother. And I stayed away from Georgia 30 years and came back to show up a new bride. And my stepmother started fixing some food. I lied like a rug and ran like a rabbit. I could get the hell out of there. I didn't want hospitality. But my main point here is that when we began to imitate this European, we were in trouble. We forgot something we need to remember right now. A people develop within a cultural and a political womb. Within that cultural and political womb, they develop certain personality chemistry that prevents them from doing certain things to their own people, prevents them from letting certain things happen to a human being. Before the coming of the European to Africa, there not only was no starvation, But it was inconceivable that you would let any human being starve, because that was an inhuman thing to do. The Europeans set the world up so people can starve. You want to keep their population low. Now, I'm not going to talk about AIDS, because I just happen to believe point blank, and I don't have my documents as well as I should, that it was a form of genocide developed in Spain for us. And spilled in over there. But if you're going to be free of this kind of genocide, then you've got to have your own chemists, your own doctors, a great variety of them, your own specialists. We have to stop our students from studying nonsense. Remember, all the Africans who come here and study management and go back to Africa to find out that kind of management is not applicable or useful in any place in Africa. So they come back to America and they work. That nation resource has trained them, yet that nation can't use them. But if you study the rise of modern Japan, after an American racist Perry went and kicked open the door, said, trade with the West, whether you like it or not, a Japanese educator, a Japanese nationalist, started calling the young people together and started sending them to the schools in the West. He didn't ask them, what would you like to study? He said, oceanography for you, medicine for you, shipbuilding for you, architecture for you, and you better bring it back. Not please. We're going to have to examine exactly the same kind of discipline on our children. But we're going to be delivered. If we are going to be delivered from dependency, we're going to have trained people to do every single thing we need. And we're going to have to join and stop the rapers and the raiders of Europe from destroying the forest that was our first drugstore. We're going to have to look at the difference between man and woman in Europe and the difference in Africa before the interference. I remember Dr. Nichols giving this example. Let's kick history back 10,000 years. Let's look at Europe and the European woman in that period, for the ice had not thawed out. And if the European woman gets angry with the man gets angry with her, we tell her to get out. She had to cop a plea. If she got out, she'd freeze to death in all that ice. She's still copping a plea. Copping a plea is part of the totality of our society. In Africa, where the woman went to the forest drugstore, got something to cure her man, cured the clothes he wore, the leather, and domesticated agriculture, found a way to feed him, found oils, way to heal him. Took care of him well, fed him well. Now he gonna come home in Africa and say, get out. Get out where? Who in the hell gonna feed you? And besides, if she did get out, she got 50 cousins, 100 uncles. And a marriage was not a marriage between two people, but between two families. And your family gonna get on you for bringing disgrace on them if you mistreat her, and her family gonna get on her for bringing disgrace if you mistreat him. So you got this support system, you got a respect you marriage. Then some fool in Europe had to come along with the I love you marriage. And you've been in trouble ever since. When those old people got together and analyzed both of you and decided that you would go together and brought you together, you stayed together. I know this sounds very unromantic to you now that Hollywood has spoiled you. But remember, in that society, everyone had one. Do you have one now? So best, if you lived in a society where the old people in your family got together and picked you one, you would at least have one. Now, but you've got your prescription. That'd be so tall, weigh so much. You're looking at the exterior. You don't know what kind of interior is there. You didn't have to check him out when the old people were doing it for you. They checked that out ahead of time. Even checked his family lineage out. And when they brought it together, it was straight. We have not studied the catastrophe of not only European interference on African life, but 2,000 years of interference from Western Asia before the coming of the Europeans. We haven't even studied the fact that the Africans were in the slave trade 1,000 years before the Europeans got into the African slave trade, and that many Arab slavery was a part of Arab life before Islam. We have not studied the world's religions and how to make all of them into instruments of liberation. And I say everything that touches your life, every social organization, every religion, everything that touches your life must be an instrument of your liberation, or you must throw it into the ash can of history. You have no time to waste. Now, a wild man named Steve Coker has introduced us to something called the Boules. Now, we didn't know about this super sorority or fraternity until he introduced us to it. My first thought, if they can do some good, let them do some good. But if they do bad, then abandon them. We came out of a society, we did have elites, we did believe in elites, but they were responsible elites. People responsible for holding us together. People responsible for making sure that things got done. And some of these responsible people were enslaved. And some of them led slave revolts in South America, in the Caribbean islands, and in the United States. They did not lose that sense of responsibility, the sense of correcting wrong in transition. We have to take an inventory of what we've got and what we're going to need to have if we're going into the 21st century. Will we listen to some of our own messengers and build a new way of life out of certain things that we discarded, out of things we didn't hear very well. Let's stop calling Booker T. Washington a Tom, and let's look at Booker T. Washington as a strategist whose strategy didn't always work. He might have scratched his head when it wasn't itching. He might have laughed when nothing was funny. But he kept Tuskegee open. He built a great school. And he said yes when he didn't mean it, so that another generation can be strong enough to say, hell no. If you look at him as a sacrificial man, and if you read him in depth, every person around Booker T. Washington contributed to this concept of self-reliance. Or it didn't stay around Booker T. Washington. You could write a masterpiece on Booker T. Washington's choice of wives. No man ever did it better. Either you served Booker and Tuskegee, or the other services were irrelevant. But he built a great school and a great idea for education. Educate people to do for themselves what they ask others to do. Even if you're going to be a servant, be a good servant and get a good salary out of it. Education for the crafts. Education for not only the maintenance of a community, but the kind of education that you will ultimately need to maintain a nation. Take his good and take his bad, and don't throw out the whole man. Of course he did compromise, but so do you. Of course, he did say a lot of public things he didn't exactly mean, but so is Jesse Jackson. But Booker T. Washington got something done over and above Jesse Jackson. And once you listen to Booker T. Washington, look at the time he lived. Then look at Booker T. Washington's concept of self-reliance. Du Bois' concept of political reliance, political consolidation, you can see why this logically led to the ideas of Marcus Garvey, who built the largest organization before our sense in Black America. And yet today, if Marcus Garvey, who was a Jamaican, it is my opinion that politically and its commitment to Africa, Jamaica has deteriorated to the point where if a real Marcus Garvey walked down the streets of Jamaica, he'd be stoned to death today. Regression based on the imitation of your slave master and your colonial master. Becoming a great color stratified island, it could have been one of the great island nations of the world. Taking on too many of the traits of its colonial master. Now, if the ideas of Booker T. Washington led to the possibilities of the implementation of the ideals of W.E.B. Du Bois, who was premature, given his time and given Washington's time. Not that W.E.B. Du Bois was wrong. He was just premature for the time. It was never a problem of W.E.B. Du Bois or Booker T. Washington. It was W.E.B. Du Bois and Booker T. Washington. It's still the same. One develop one method, another one develop another method. When we came to the concept of African return advocated by Marcus Garvey, you have to understand the nature of his advocacy. He did not say everybody just walk up, get, pack up and go back to Africa. He wanted selective return. People can build nations. If you study his Liberia scheme, you'll understand what I'm talking about. He had put steam shovels, brickyards, all these things that goes into the structure of a nation into Liberia. And had Liberia been the point nation, the example of what the future African nation could be other than a nation of Uncle Tom, the African independence movement would have come two generations early. Two nations in this world had to succeed, and they could have brought the African independence explosion into being 50 years earlier, Haiti and Liberia. Liberia, a sick nation then and now, because the Caribbeans and black Americans who went there said that their mission is to civilize their heathen brothers. Hung up with the white missionary zeal in an African country, they formed themselves into cliques until the indigenous people grew strong enough to kick butt. But many of the indigenous people had been bought off by the CIA and the FBI. And so that backfired too. When you open yourself up to be taken by another people and you complain one against the other. Haiti is a different case because Haiti had brought off a true revolution. After the revolution, the mulatto elite adopted a French constitution. A French constitution for a predominantly African nation. Had Haiti become an African state other than an imitation French state, we would have had the role model of what an African state could have been. We would have had it as early as the 18th century. But America made a decision that no slave state is going to exist, because if this state would develop from slavery exists, other slaves will get ideas. Because the Haitian Revolution has set in motion, to some extent, the massive slave revolts in the United States. Gabriel Prosser, Denmark Vesey, in that term. If we have one example any place, that example can spread to other places. And if you understand what I'm saying right now, you will understand why powerful forces in the world, America and in Europe, had to destroy Nkrumah's example. Because if one example of a well-managed state appeared in Africa, managed by Africans, from the mentality of Africa, from the creative genius of Africa, then all states could do the same. They had to knock that one off. And knocking that one off, they created imitation European states. And there's not a state in Africa that is an African-created state. Because the African has lost from his memory the kind of state he had before the Europeans came. He had a state that had every element of democracy without using the name. Every element of the best elements of the religions of the world without using the name of any of them. Then someone had to go formalize it. And these sharing states given to people according to their needs, other than their ability to work, to earn. Because it is human. It makes sense to give a man with 6 children more food than a man with 2 children. And you do not argue about the earning capacity of the one with 6 as against the one with 2. He's got 6 children, he's contributing something to the state. He's part of the totality of the state. His needs are greater because he's got more to take care of. It is humane for the state to give him or to assist him. This is the proper welfare state. Every state that's worth being called a state is a welfare state because it looks after the welfare of its people. I'm not talking about supporting unemployed people. I'm not talking about locals. I'm not talking about relief chiefs, welfare chiefs, or anything like that. I'm talking about you create a condition where there's gainful employment for everyone in the state, and there's a way to divide the resources so that no one in the state will starve and no one will be without shelter. Because it seems absolutely inhuman for another human being to be without food, be without shelter. You don't even debate his earning capacity before you give it to him, because it's inhumane not to give it to him. What you have to understand is that the temperament of Europe, the intentions of Europe, was from the beginning anti-Christian and anti-democratic, by their definition, and still is. Now, if you understand what Africa has to do, and now let's explain why they had to knock off Nkrumah. Well, when I'm talking about Nkrumah, I'm talking about the man whose mind made him, George Padmore. And if you study the Pan-African Conference in London, 1945, most of the ideas charged to Nkrumah were the ideas of George Padmore. Padmore didn't worry about this, Nkrumah didn't worry about it. Whosoever got the ball and can carry the ball. We ain't got no debate about who put the air in the ball or who invented the ball, whose leather got the ball. There ain't no debate. That the best ball carrier carry the ball. And Nkrumah was the best ball carrier politically we had in the world at that time. For he had taken Africa for his political walk in the sun. And he had frightened the colonialists who've been stealing from Africa indefinitely. He'd frighten the people who've been raping Africa of its mineral wealth, of its hydroelectric wealth. He'd frighten the people who knew all along what is still true, Africa is the world's richest continent, richest in hydroelectric potential, richest in agricultural possibility, richest in farmable land. The last mineral resource in all the world and the last geographic resource in all the world. Europe is dying. Now, there is a plan in the world so monstrous that you won't believe it. There is a plan to gradually depopulate Africa and be taken over by Europeans with the assistance of some Asians and with the able assistance of Arabs using Islam as their imperial arm. See, if you're gonna get so dewy-eyed over Christianity, the European concept, you're gonna get dewy-eyed over Islam, you're not gonna get this point. There will be no starvation in Somalia, except certain Muslim thugs are fighting among themselves in preventing the movement of food from one part of the country to another. We better watch this importation of foreign food. The Indians had to wash those blankets, they wouldn't have died. When you look at the countries in Africa with the highest degree of AIDS, these were the countries that got inoculations from the World Health Organization. Who can prove that they wasn't planting AIDS? It was meant for us and it spilled over onto them. It is still more catastrophe for us. We build up less resistance against things alien to our culture and alien to our environment and things that other people can hold into their body because there's a degenerate keeper in their body and we don't have one. They'll knock us, that same thing will knock us right off. How many of us we here dying of pneumonia? The weather is damp and cold and some of the most miserable, creepy weather in the world. He's out there in that weather with his little silly umbrella, never catching a cold. He's got used to it. You go out there, you've been to hospital the next day. You didn't grow up there. I was in Nigeria and I tried to play Mr. All-Wise American. Place called Zaire. Going to the post office and I said, post office just right over there. They said, they told me, Mr. Carter, where you at? I said, it's right over there. All these kids out here wearing their hats with no hats. You know, I said, go to the post office and come back. They said, Mr. Clark, where you at? I insisted. On my way to the post office, I was staggering, almost having sunstroke. So the Africans came and got me. They took me to my room and gave me some warm water. And they didn't give me cold water until later that day, to my body temperature. They saved me from sunstroke. But I kept saying, all those kids were out there with no hat. They said, those kids were born here. Simple as that. And another time, I'm going to an African open air restaurant, and I'll get back on coast in a little while. And they were serving the African beef stew. I know it was a little hot, but Africans have the hottest pepper in the world. African and West Indies got some of the hottest pepper in the world. So you kind of guard yourself. You just don't overdo it. He says, I don't think you like this beef stew. It's kind of hot. I said, but the kids are eating it. You know, I can't eat it. What do you think I am? I ate it. They just brought me the water. The minute I swallowed, then I kept that same old story about the kids are doing it. They said, these kids were born here. When the child grows up, the mother puts a little hot pepper on her breast while feeding the child. So the child grows up with a feeling for that pepper, with a feeling for the kind of food that grows and develops in the country where he lives. And certain kinds of peppers are cleanser. Sometimes it's a laxative. Now, I didn't know all of this until someone begin to kind of take over me and my health and read books about things and tell. I was a man, I know all about history, but there's a whole lot of things I didn't learn about my own body until I settled down and started learning. Now let's get back to the lecture because I got to end this. And my mission here is to let you know that it is time that we shout nation time, but shout it with a vengeance, and don't shout it until you know what goes into the making of a nation, until you know the responsibility of a nation, until you are ready to assume that responsibility, including defense of a nation. Not only ready to man their ships, ready to make their ships. And once you equip yourself in this way, then shout nation time. For if then it will be nation time. And if an enemy comes at the door, you can deal with him, violently or non-violently, depending on the needs. We as a people have been 3,000 years under siege. Africa has always had and still have something other people want, think they can't do without, and don't want to pay for. We have always been the prize. We've always been the source of great energy and great imagination. We have misdirected our energy. We can spend more energy on the dance floor than is needed to build 10 cities. We're very creative people, and we're on the stage of the world. And most of the time we have no script. We got to make up the role. We got to act or get off the stage. You got no script, so you make up one. So innovation becomes a part of our existence. And if we put the kind of innovation in building governments and communities that a good jazz player can put through a horn, we won't be dependent on other people. I remember working at NBC, and down on 7th Avenue, there was a place called the Metropole where half-naked girls danced over the bar to encourage the drunks to buy more drinks. And Red Allen was there playing with his little trio. Kind of hard times when they got to play at a place like that over all these naked women. Jazz singers, but you know, taking it aside, you find a job, well, you can find a job. I'm coming out on my lunch hour, I says, "Hey, Red, what's the secret of you and that horn?" He said, "You know one thing, Johnny Boy, I always play this horn the same way every night." And he qualified it. If my gal's sweet, I play one way. If she's evil, I play another way. If I have a good steak, I play another way. If a bad steak, I play another way. But you know one thing, Johnny, I always play this horn the same way every night. I began to pay attention to those great geniuses like Charlie Parker. For 7 straight times, I heard Charlie Parker play "Ain't She Sweet," and he never played it the same time, the same way, any one time. And yet all the time he was playing "Ain't She Sweet." Innovation within a restricted form. What I'm saying is that we can do more creative things for ourselves than we are doing. Now who in the hell told you you can't make a pair of shoes? You're making them for other people. Why not just make them under your own supervision? Why can't we start by doing the durable thing? Doing the thing that's not high tech. Making a shoe is not high tech. And why can't we remember that Metzalinger, a black man, invented a shoe machine in the first place? Why can't we go back at this declaration? I won't wear any clothes my people don't make. Why can't we understand what Martin Luther King did not understand about Mahatma Gandhi? Mahatma Gandhi wasn't no love of black people, no love of any people except the people of India. He didn't love all of them. He was an Indian nationalist. In South Africa, he found several organizations. He never could get along with the blacks. The United Colors, the United Natives League. By the time he left, a deal was cut. A man named Mr. Adorama made a deal with the South African government. If the Indians don't have to carry a pass, they'll keep quiet while the Africans carry the pass. They're still quiet. We are the only people that permit people to live among us indefinitely without declaring any loyalty to us. In the 21st century, we must get into the habit of asking every person that comes into our house, what is your commitment to this house? If you're not loyal to this house, let the door hit you. When my enemy is at the door, I want to see you swinging a weapon. This is a cruel thing to say, yet it's part of survival. In my early army training days at Camp Lee, Virginia, when black soldiers were fighting just to ride the bus, even in the back, the white soldier pushed them out of the back, we began a fighting technique. And they said, now, once, cause we got on the bus and some soldiers, man, you been starting this fight. When we got back to the back, we got on him. So you're wrong, brother. Everybody's right when the crackers is around. All of us are right. And they told me, you with your big head, your book reading self, if a fight starts on the bus, I want to see every black soldier whipping on a white behind. And if he's not doing it when he gets back to the barracks, then we're going to whip his. So when I got on the bus, I strategically picked me out one that I thought I could take. Small New England type. So when the fight started, I just started wailing on one. He looked up and said, "Why are you doing that? What I did to you?" He did that. Well, I ain't did nothing to you either. You came to Africa, you didn't ask us democratic way. All you Africans, hold up your hands. Let's vote. See which one want to get on the boat. It wasn't democratic. Democracy didn't bring me here. It was the violation of democracy that brought me here. And when the Pope in 1455 said to Spain and Portugal, "You are both authorized to reduce to servitude all infidel people," he had justified the European slave trade. We need to look at this 500-year ordeal, look at 1,000 years of independent states in Africa before, look at the devastation of East Africa by accommodation of Arabs and Portuguese, look at the devastation that came before the Portuguese. If you belong to Islam, I'm not saying quit Islam. I'm saying turn it into an instrument of liberation or quit it. right now in Africa, in the Sudan, people are being killed solely because they're not Muslim. Senegalese being expelled from Mauritania because the Arabs intend to whiten up that country. Any kind of European can come in, statesman or whore, they can get in if they're white, or so-called white. I have met many black scholars who said they are Muslim. I have not met one who is a scholar on that faith. I have not met one who can make a comparative study between the black side of Islam and the Arab side of Islam that is totally different. It is only in the black side of Islam that we find genuine rebels. Muhammad Ahmad of the Sudan, called the Mahdi. Bin Abdullah Hassan, called the Mad Mullah of Somaliland. He's a devout Muslim. Sekou Toure's grandfather, Soumaré Touré. Ousmane Donfolio in Nigeria. Where are the radicals among the Arab Islam? It's only in the black side of Islam that a woman became head of state. Elmina, who mastered the state of Zaire and built walls to protect the city. Some of these walls are still there. There's a lot of folklore and a lot of lies about Amina. A lot of lies about her. They said when she conquered a city and took on a new lover, if his performance wasn't up to par, she'd execute him in the morning. I didn't want that rumor to get out. Even stars don't perform at their best every time. I find it was an exaggeration most spread by her enemies. But this was an able woman, head of state. Now, what is all of this leading to? It is leading to asking you to reconsider your concept of following other people and develop an idea and a spirit of following yourself. I'm asking you to come out of this individual mood and maybe re-enter the collective, because I see no other solution for us except the collective. The collective community, collective buying, defense of our children, sending our children into schools with a mission. When I visit the Garvey School in LA, seeing these children perform at 2, better than some children perform at 10, send them read and explain difficult political writings. See them develop a rap in Spanish, in Arabic, and in English. We have the imagination to bring radical changes to the whole world. But we're going to have to take a strong look at ourselves. All this internal struggle engineered by outside forces, sometimes by professors of sociology in white schools. They invented a wall between black men and black women. And because they invented a wall, black men and black women think they've got to have to follow the script and have a wall. Neither one seems to know that there's no place for either one to go except toward each other. And without them, without this, we can't make a nation. and that there's no place for any one of us is going to be socially comfortable on a permanent basis, permanently away from each other. I'm not saying everything is well, because I know it's not. We're going to have to start doing something about our own individual relationship one to the other. We're going to have to reconsider some of the things said by Elijah Muhammad and Malcolm X, totally aside from Islam. We're going to have to start communicating with that vast population of blacks in prison. Because some of the best minds we've got is developing that. If they come out with good intentions, they can contribute to the revolution. But if they went in with bad intentions, they're going to come out with worse intentions. We have to raise some questions. Why are so many of them there? Why so many people committing crimes and are not there? So many other people. But to raise some questions about the total population. Now let's dream a little bit and see if we can come to a close. Suppose Haiti has sent a large population to Guyana. The last election that the East Indians won would have been won by the blacks, because the blacks had the numbers. At what point are we going to understand that we're going to have to deal with brown racism and yellow racism too? Now, I might admire some of the technical things that the Japanese done to free themselves and to reconstitute themselves after defeat and after two atomic bombs. But I have no illusion about them being yellow racists, because I know they are. People look after themselves first and foremost, and you're going to have to learn how to do the same thing. You got more to offer to your community than the people who economically control your community. And besides, controlling your community is a job. And we need more jobs. We need to look at this whole concept based on nation framework. We should have everything that goes into the making of a nation within the framework of Black America, including the equivalent of a Secretary of State, Secretary of Commerce, Secretary of Labor. 30 million people. I've gone to Finland, has 7 million people. They got 2 symphony orchestras. We don't have one. National dance group. We don't have one. All the Jewish people on the face of the earth are less than one half of the black population in the United States. On someone else's property, they carved out a nation. The name of that nation replaced God in their vocabulary. By the astute use of that nation, they get more aid than all the black nations in the world put together. They got their political thing together, and we don't have ours together. What I'm calling on you to do is to start making a place for your children and their children and the still more beautiful ones still not born, I'm calling on you to seek dynamic change in the world. And do not waste your time in schemes that lead no place. And do not use any religion to judge and turn on your own people. In as much as you create the basis for all of it, you can discard all of it and start afresh. It was yours in the first place. You have a right to change it if that's what you want to do. But understand, we should not continue to be a people begging at the door of beggars and stealing from thieves. We should develop our own framework. We should develop a place for our children. We should watch them carefully. I think you can tell how a child handles a fork, how he'll handle a mathematical problem, if you know children well enough. The order in that child's life at an early age tells you what kind of order he will have in his life as a married man, if you watch him close enough and understand children in the progression of growth well enough. We must end all these cleavages. Let us have our differences, but do not let these differences tear us apart to the point where we cannot build again what we had before. And that is a great container that I refer to as nation. Understand that Africa never had the nation state. And the nation state, as developed by the Europeans, is a straitjacket. The African had the territorial state, clusters of states within a territory, functioning side by side with different belief systems and sometimes with the same belief system. And that way you could have massive universities. Unless you dream and make it so, it's not going to ever be so. If you put nearly $3 billion in the economy of the United States, if just half of that money was directed toward improving yourself in your own community, small factories, first starting in the community and then extending out, first serving only yourself, then serve anybody who needs the service, you can develop the nation structure without having a nation. I'm merely talking about the Africans in the United States. The Africans in the Caribbean islands have a state, but it's an imitation European state. And the Africans in Africa have a state, but that's an imitation European state. It is the function of every teacher, every preacher, every public person among us to ask and answer the question, how will my people stay on this earth? How will they be fed? How will they be housed? How will they be educated? This is the heart and the meaning and the definition of Pan-African nationalism. I say we must extend it beyond that base to a concept of an African world union. Realize in your weakness, you may not be weak. You may have been programmed into weakness because you have not discovered your real strength. It takes unity and more than unity. If you unify, you got to unify for something and around something. You got to have a plan. We have to stop being too dependent on the charismatic leader and think of the charismatic program. if indeed we have a charismatic program and the leader dies, and we're on page 14, we turn to page 15, bury the man, continue the plan. But the plan must always lead you someplace. The plan must always be developed to make you free of dependency on other people. I don't mean you should not relate to other people, because you should. But you should relate as equals. You can barter, you can trade, but you should not always be in a position for you cannot barter. Enter no alliance that you do not control. If you enter an alliance with me and break the alliance, I want to be in a position to punish you for doing so. But I'll enter an alliance with you. My final words is just a summation of all of my words. I have said before, I wanted to make a principal statement to my people. And there are many ways of saying, I love you. I have used my life to say to a people, not only that I love you, I am committed to you, I am hopeful for you, you give me the meaning for existence, and without you, I would not have a meaning quite as strong as the meaning that keeps me alive and keeps me going and keeps me working 7 days a week. In essence, you can change the world if at first you change yourself. Thank you.
Before you leave, we're going to have probably two people to come up for questions and answers in the interest of time. And then we'll have a few announcements, and then Brother Dr. Wade Nobles will do a closing. So we're going to set the microphone, or there's one right down here already. And if anybody has any questions, we'll allow for two of them. And then we'll go with some announcements. Okay, sister.
Dr. Clark, last week after the Malcolm X movie came out, I heard you on the radio elaborating on it. And I would like to ask you if you would speak some on Malcolm tonight for this audience, because we have a lot of very young people here who did not know him.
Well, I saw the movie. I felt responsible for doing it. I knew Malcolm better than most people, and after his death, I did not say a public word about knowing him. So many phonies appeared saying they knew Malcolm, and I didn't want to be confused with them, so I just kept quiet. Now, as for the movie, it did prove that Spike Lee can make a major movie. He can handle a big canvas on a movie. But the Malcolm X I knew wasn't in the film. And the intimate thing, and very few of the words I heard Malcolm X speak was in the film. If any of them were in there, they were accidental. And his best speeches were not in the film at all. and that certain words were used in the speeches in the films that were not a part of the vocabulary of Malcolm X. Near the end of the film, when they made him an integrationalist, that's a misinterpretation of an observation. He observed certain things in Mecca. He didn't advocate anything. And he wasn't changing his mind about white people. He said certain individual things about white people. He said near the end of his life, there's certain some white people he could work with. Hell, he said that all along. That wasn't enough. There's some white people I can work with, but I know who the enemy is. I mean, there's some white people who have opened good doors for me and done research for me, and I want people to go through files and get some information, but if I show up, they're going to close the files. And they've gone and got those files. They're mostly students and mostly girl students at that, because they're very obedient. They say, yes, professor, go in that file, go to the Slavic section, go to that section, that library, look under that tablet. They go get it and have it. They don't even know what they're doing, but they end up doing a decent paper and they're getting a decent mark out of it, and they're very happy. They don't feel exploited. I mean, so I'm disassociating myself from white people. I used to work on the Lower East Side in New York, and many of these young Jewish boys later in years owned button factories and owned clothing factories, and I could always go to one of them for a job, you know, doing something. The pay was poor, of course, and they wouldn't dare pay a white person that poorly, but, well, I had no choice, but at least I did have a job through my connection with them. And in later years, one was a lawyer, and I got into some trouble promoting a little magazine called the Harlem Quarterly, and really naive of giving a public dance without a cabaret license, selling liquor without a liquor license. Got arrested, and a Jewish lawyer friend of mine that I used to know on the Lower East Side went to jail, went to court several times, and I didn't know what he was doing. He looked as, I don't like that judge. To postpone it again. He kept postponing and says, you know, John, I've got the right judge today. And I still didn't know what hit me. I was with another fellow. We came up, and this judge was, say, I compliment you, gentlemen, for the caliber of legal service you have brought into my court. I said, what the hell is this? You have shown discretion. I can tell by the nature of your crime and the reputation you've had before. You've been in no trouble before. I decided to plead for you. You plead naivete. You just didn't know better. So I'm going to dismiss this case, and besides, it's my lunch hour. I'm going out of the courtroom, and I asked the lawyer. He said, oh, I forgot to tell you. That's my cousin. So I got my white connection. I use them well, but I ain't no fool. I'm not going to choose no milk over chocolate. And you know what I mean. Now, about the Malcolm X film, the scene in Mecca was overdone. Mecca's no heaven. There's still discrimination against the African people in Mecca. Malcolm got the royal treatment because he was Malcolm. The Arabs are still in the slave trade. Now blacks are still rationalizing it for them. The most significant thing of Malcolm's
visit to Africa was his visit to West Africa, his contact with the Organization of African Unity, his visit to Kwame Nkrumah. That was left out of the film altogether. The film de-revolutionized Malcolm, sanitized him, made him acceptable to white people. Malcolm's message to the grassroots left out. That's one of the great revolutionary speeches made in the 20th century. Left out altogether. His famous speech at Abyssinia Baptist Church, 2 weeks before he was pushed out of the Nation of Islam, being introduced by Adam Powell, one of the few ministers that had enough nerve to invite Malcolm into his pulpit. Left out of the film. I thought the part with his wife, Betty, was fairly well done. The prison was drawn out. Now, if you think those white scenes with the white woman was bad, they were so raw that the white backers of the film ordered them out. Spike Lee got a sex complex. I don't know what's wrong with it. Adults don't get all excited over sex. It's a nice thing we do when we get around to it. Ain't the bane of all existence. As nice as it is, there's quite a few other things in life that we also do. There's quite a few other things that we also enjoy with each other. Without that, I'm not knocking it. And I yield to no man my acceptance and appreciation of it. But it's not the end all of everything. You can live a healthy life, without, for a protracted period without it, but if you convince yourself. Don't think what you call a biological necessity is a biological necessity. It's a biological need. I grant that. But Spike Lee's kind of offset. But he did prove, if he ever had the social consciousness to do so, he could produce a great movie. But with his mentality and with his commercial hustlerism, I doubt it. In the final analysis, I'm glad the movie introduced a lot of young people to the character Malcolm X. Now they'll read his autobiography, and they'll read his speeches, and they'll go beyond the movie. That part is good. Take people beyond the ceremony into something that has substance. That's a hope. And in that respect, the movie is positive. Other respects, I think it's kind of negative in what it failed to show about the depth and the plans of Malcolm X. We will never know what Malcolm X could have been, or Martin Luther King, because both of them were cut down while they were still growing. We must ask some serious questions about ourselves. Why do we let such valuable people be taken away from us? If we got part of that lesson out of the film, then it was worthwhile, misconceptions and all. Thank you.
Okay, Brad.
Okay. Hello, Dr. Clark. It's a pleasure being here and experience you in person. I've heard you speak many times on tapes, and I must say this is quite a touching experience to be able to experience you personally. My question is that, as we listen to your talk and the direction that you're pointing us in. You know, I can't help to say that, a lot of people, and I hate to do this, but I know a lot of people will hear your talk and it would go in one ear and out the other, in essence, in reference to taking action to the things that you're aspiring to. So my question is that if there were, say, a strategy that we can undertake that could bring that cohesiveness that we are all, that we need to be able to progress forwardly. Now, if it was done in a phasal type procedure, what would you suggest to be phase one? And I asked Dr. Clark.
If we're building a new society, we need to start with ourselves, our families, our communication, our communities. We need to be better acquainted with Africans who live outside of Africa, better acquainted with Africans who live in Africa. We need to remove a lot of the misconceptions among us, all the strangeness that Professor Fowler refers to in her poem on Pan-Africanism. We need to look at each other again. We need to adjust to each other's personality again. We need to remove all the strangeness that has grown up between us through all the seasons and all the centuries. We need to become a whole people again. We need to be acquainted with each other again. We need to speak to each other without feeling fear. This won't come about unless we work at it. And if you think nation, the very act of thinking nation gives you a list of assignments that you have to carry out in order to create the nation in actuality. The minute you think nation, you've got more work to do than you can do in a lifetime. And if you understand the nature of nation, you have no excuse for not doing that work. I think we should start with ourselves. Start with a mirror, start with a partner, see who's staring back at you, and say to that partner, you and I can change the world, and we'll do it right now. We won't just talk about it. We won't be at the same corner the next year talking about the same subject without improving ourselves one iota. We will engage in revolutionary change. We will find the map that tells us where we are in history. And we will find that compass that tells us how we relate to human geography, political and otherwise. I have called my own pursuit a mission of my existence, the all-encompassing mission of my existence. And out of this mission, hopefully, will become a legacy that I will leave behind something that is useful in a long range that my own people can use as they pursue liberation. Let each individual find his or her mission. Having done so, then find the collective mission that relates to all the African people on the face of the earth in particular, and the whole world in general.
Before Williams, who is no longer with us on the physical plane, but he'll always be with us in spirit. So if we could give a moment of silence.